complex, so that doesn't become an issue anymore. That's what's important. And again, it requires a little bit of knowledge. Not a lot. Okay. There's two kinds of flash systems that you'll have access to. One, you can turn on lights. How many other points you can? You ever try to use your flash with macro? Does it work? Why doesn't it work? It's too bright. And look, the subject is right here, and where's the flash shooting? Out that way. It's not made for that. Okay. How do you outsmart it? Well, here, you can do this. There's a high-tech outsmarting tool. You simply tone down, you underexpose by probably 2 f-stops. You point this so that this reflects off of that and bounces onto the subject. I didn't do it.
What is that card? Is it just
a piece of paper? Oh, I turned it
off.
It's a laminated piece of paper. It's an alligator clip, it's a piece of wire, and that's that tripod screw I gave you. Okay, so there's the image. It's too bright, but it is sharp, it is in focus, and the light is on it. So all you have to do is adjust the exposure, and you've got a perfectly valid system for using your point and shoot. You don't need this wire, you can hold it. Or, you know, that's kind of, but you can do that. So just because you have point and shoot doesn't mean you can't use this on your point and shoot, okay? Or you can have a lovely assistant to come with you and hold the card. No?
She says no.
So it's as simple as that. If you have point shoots, don't despair. You can do that. All right. The other thing is a dedicated flash system. Here's what it looks like. You're going to go, holy crap. Here's what it looks like. Okay? What this does is this is smart. When you push the shutter, it bounces light off the subject. When it's bright exposed, it shuts itself off. I'll show you the camera. Show you how difficult this is. Perfectly exposed, you know. Life size. And I didn't do a thing except turn the flash on and turn the camera on. Okay? That's all I did. And it works. It's not infallible, but it is pretty much as idiot-proof as photography can be. Flash photography. You say, well, that's all well and good. What's the problem with that? This system right here is $3,700. Don't just come out. I have a solution for you. All right, let me show you what you can do. This is what you can do. These are all flash photos, you know. They're all with flash. None of these, you know, none of these you can say, well, that's a flash photo, right? You simply can't tell. All right. So, 100 millimeter macro panavicoid dedicated flash system. Here's what it looks like. Why am I spending so much time on this? Here's what it can do. Hummingbirds in flight. You name it. You can't tell that's a flash photo. You simply can't tell. All right. Shootings on digital point and shoot. That's what I just showed you how to do with that little piece of paper. Dimming down. The other thing you can do is if you can't dim down the flash on your camera, how do you dumb down the flash on your camera? simply put something in front of it. You know what's the best? One thickness of toilet paper. That's about 1.5 f-stops, and that's about how much it all costs. You simply take a piece of toilet paper in front of the flash. You can use Mylar, you can use something sophisticated, but toilet paper doesn't do well in the rain, but then, you know. And that will dump down the flash, and it'll, and you know, if you use that bounce thing, you simply direct the light on the subject, and you'll get great images. I mean, you know, you'd be amazed at what they look like. There's one. There's a spider. All with that stupid little system, right? Okay. And here's this other one. The lens I have on there is a macro lens. Here's that super macro lens. It uses the same flash, requires steady hands, because it starts at life size and goes to 5x life size, which means you can't use it as a regular lens. It's just a macro lens. Very little working distance, okay? But what can you do with it? You ever seen the head of a doodle bug? You know, those pits in the sand? You know how big those things are? You ever looked at the face of an immature jumping spider? I mean, boy, there's a whole bunch of crap out there. You have no idea what's going on. You know, that's what's important, and that's what's cool about macro photography, because we know there'll be wolves at Imaquan, right? Wolf spiders, wolves nonetheless. So, all right, so that's what you can do. Macro photography, it's important to deal with, understand your background, okay? You got really close to something, really simplified the image, you've made it as simple as possible, and you got a whole bunch of clutter in the background. Okay. So, you have three things to think about. Working distance, you know how close you are to the subject. The shorter the focal length lens, the more you're going to have to deal with the background, okay? The depth of field, so you got to worry about that. And then you have to worry about the space between the last plane of the subject and the background. Right? If it was too close, you're going to get a bunch of crap in there that you don't want. So here's a few tricks. What's the difference between these two photos? Working distance. This one, I used a longer focal length macro lens and an extension tube. This one, I used a 50 millimeter lens, and the background is there. Then you arrange it as best as you can, because it's going to be there. There's nothing you can do about it. Okay. So what technique was used with each? This is the 200 millimeter lens with an extension tube. This is a 100 millimeter lens, handheld. So this one is closer. So you got to deal with the background. Here you don't have to deal with the background. The working distance is important. A few more tricks. Here's the same image, the same photo, but to show you how using different techniques. If you're going to do a field guide to the pipevine swallowtail larvae, you'd probably want this image. If you want to do a poster and do what's the best, you want to use this image. What's the difference between the two? The same. Okay? Decide on how you want to treat the subject and work accordingly. And it's still those same depth of field, you know, all those sorts of things that we're talking about. But ideally is you treat every subject in a whole bunch of different ways because you never know how you're going to use it. Alright. Here's an example of how to do things. All right, here's the same subject, same day, same setup, a 200 millimeter lens with an extension tube behind it. Okay, I'm going to show you three images. Okay. The question is, what are the commonalities of each image? The spider in each one is exactly the same size, right? The plane of focus is exactly the same because I'm parallel to the spider web and the spider. What's different about them all? Background, what's another way to say background? Depth of field is different on all of them. With this one, too much. Which is the worst photo? This one. Crappy photo. Should have thrown that away, right? This one is better, this one is fine. Well, the difference between each image, depth of field, and lighting. This is on, if you went out today and shot a spider web on today with a bright sun, harsh contrast, that's what it's going to look like. If you get a cloud over it, it's going to look like this. If you wait till early morning, it's going to look like that. Okay? So you can see how different things can look. Good, good, icky. Right? Which works and which do not? This one works, this one works, this one doesn't work. What else would you use here? What else did I use there? I just talked to you. Split neutral density filter. Look at the, you know, otherwise this would have been pure white and just uglier than sin. So the and then here's, you know, foreground. So all it is a balancing act. Little differences, three photos. Same thing, same time. All right, this is using this double flash system, which I showed you here. This is using a double flash with a different, on a different setting, which I'll tell you more about. And this is using natural light. Okay? Why is this one different from this one, this one from different? Because these two are handheld. This one had to be on a tripod to hold it steady. These did not, okay? This one, the background showed up. This one, the background did not show up. And that was a conscious choice that you make. And you don't even know why right now. But you can just show, you can do bam, bam, bam. Everybody will like a different one. I don't know, I don't care. Okay, so the key is to good back attack, a good technique, maximize depth of field, small opening, parallel to the subject plane, and use good composition, don't throw all out, you know, still compose the subject, variety of treatments on each subject, you know, you see something, you're never going to see it again. Something about it. Be able to achieve the image size you desire. There's nothing worse than a macro photo that's not a macro photo. Oh man, I wish I could have gotten that bigger. You know? Well, the subject is not going to get bigger, so you're going to have to do something, right? Understand supplementary lighting. If you're going to choose to use electronic flash, you got to know how it works. And you'll have to learn to create the view with the background. Still the same thing. You've got to keep your eyes open, so every time you get an opportunity, you take it. This was a captive owl. I'm like, well, I'm not going to take a picture of a stupid captive owl, because everybody and his brother's got one, but everybody's brother didn't get that close to a captive owl. So you got to look for different opportunities. In Ecuador, I was having trouble photographing hummingbirds until I said, these aren't hummingbirds, these are big insects. And then my mental state, you know, so the same system applies. So, you want to photograph, ever seen goldenrods and those bulbs on goldenrods? You ever wonder what made those? You bring them in indoors in the winter, in the springtime, little flies will emerge, okay? Have you ever seen beetles hatch from an egg? Happens every day. Ever seen skeletonized leaves in the water? Skeletonizing the leaves. Well, these guys, these are 2 millimeters long. Okay? There's a mated pair. It's a whole new world because you're looking at things in a way that you've never looked at before. Okay. So, why the hell did I tell you all that? Because I don't know. lights. Last year, 2 years ago, we had a gentleman in the Cash Car Discovery, and then he also took the Sangamon Corridor Car Discovery. I won't tell you his name, but he once asked me, he says, you know, I don't really participate in a car discovery. Is there anything I can do to help them? I said, sure, Bruce, or whatever his name is.
We'll call him Brad.
I said, I'd like you to buy 2 macro camera systems for use by the Corps of Discovery. He says, how much are they? And I said, they're $3,600 a piece. So guess what he did? He bought 2 of them for us. Okay? And it's this system plus that super macro lens. Okay, so that's absolutely state of the art. There is nothing better. There's nothing else for macro photography. And right now, one of them is in Champaign, and they're not using it. So in September, I'm going to bring it over here. Okay, and it'll be here. So you two will be in charge of it. Okay, and what we'll do.
I know, not help.